5 more of my 100 tips to help you cook better. And of course, these are all about baking. Kicking off with how to whip cream.
Whipping cream. Now, the important part here is whipping the cream to a 3/4 stage. If we over-whip it, it will split, so be very careful. Double cream, in. Now, when we whisk things, we whisk it in the shape of a figure of eight. And if you spin the bowl as you whip the cream, you get to release it from the bottom, so it whips evenly. Whisk, 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 and it should just sit inside the whisk and start to sort of fall out. Just perfect. 3/4 stage, double cream, done.
Room temperature cream whips much faster than cold, so you'll need to take your cream out of the fridge 30 minutes before you want to whip it. Unless, of course, you want to work on your biceps. A great tip to prevent milk and cream from boiling over in a saucepan is to simply lay a wooden spoon across the top. The cream bubbles will rise up and hit the wooden handle and then fall back into the pan instead of bubbling over. Sticky stuff like treacle and golden syrup can be a real mess to measure out. My tip is to rub the spoon with a neutral oil like rapeseed, and any sticky ingredients will slide straight off. Kicking off with how to handle pastry.
Lightly flour the surface, pastry on top, rolling pin. Now, the secret now is don't overwork the pastry. Firm push, turn the pastry round, and this helps to even the pastry. Turn and roll. Now, as it starts to crack, don't worry. Just by pushing it back together, it sort of unites the pastry immediately. Apply pressure, turn the pastry. Now, the average thickness is down to a £1 coin. Back on to the rolling pin, and look, beautiful.
For the neatest edge on tarts and quiches, my tip is to let the pastry hang over the side of the tin when you bake it. Trim around the edge once the pastry is cooked. It will give you a cleaner edge and prevent it from shrinking. My tip for even rising is to place cakes and tarts in the centre of the oven so the air can circulate all the way around them. To test your cake to make sure it's done, insert a knife, skewer, or even a piece of spaghetti in the centre. If there's mixture stuck to it, it's not done yet. If it comes out clean, your cake's ready. If you don't have any baking beans to hand for blind baking, you can use any rice, grain or pulse. You won't be able to cook with them afterwards, but do keep them to reuse them next time. When you're folding egg whites or whipped cream into cake mixtures, you want to retain as much air in the mixture as you can. My tip, use a metal spoon, as the sharp, thin edge will keep more of the air in. Starting with how to cook duck breast perfectly the slow way.
Duck breast. Never be scared about cooking this bird. Absolutely delicious, very healthy. First, oven on, 200 degrees. And then, salt, pepper. Now, the salt will help to extract the water out of the fat. Non-stick pan, no oil, but start the duck breast in the pan cold. Skin side down, it feels and sounds a little bit weird. But as we put them into a cold pan and turn the heat up gradually, it starts to release the fat. If we put them into a hot pan, it seals them in and the fat stays in there. We want to render that fat down. 90% of that duck breast will be cooked on its skin. It keeps the duck nice and moist, but more importantly, it stays crispy. Once the fat comes out, turn the duck over. Nice, high, hot heat. Seal the duck. Now they're going in the oven. Skin side down, 200, 6 to 8 minutes. If your pan's got a plastic handle on it, then transfer the duck breast onto a tray, but make sure you put the tray into the oven to get hot first. Cooking duck is like cooking a piece of beef. You can't slice it piping hot, all the goodness runs out. Just quickly turn it over. Push your fingers in there, and it's slightly resistant, but still quite bouncy. And that confirms they're quite pink in the centre. But the important part now is leaving that to rest, let them cool down, and then we'll slice them. Keep that excess duck fat, and there you go. Next time you're sauteing potatoes, you just take them to a completely different level. Now, slicing the duck, just Slice it at an angle, not too thin. If you slice it thinly, it goes cold quickly, so nice thick slices. Nice crispy skin on top, and a beautiful plump roasted duck. All the white fat gone, nice crispy skin, and absolutely delicious.
Another slow cooking tip is, when slow cooking stews and casseroles, fat will rise to the surface. To get rid of any excess oils, my tip is to remove them with kitchen paper before serving. This also works brilliantly on gravies and sauces. Many great slow cooked dishes start by browning the meat. As the meat cooks, lots of flavors get stuck to the pan. To get it into your sauce, deglaze with wine, stock, or vinegar. Never add soft herbs at the beginning of slow cooking. They're all too delicate. The tip is to add them at the end for that hit of fresh flavour and vibrant colour. A great tip when frying fish is to always fry skin side down to keep it crispy. And always lay the fillets away from you when adding to the pan to prevent hot oil from splashing towards you. First, how to make a fantastic chicken stock, a classic slow cook recipe that gets amazing flavour from simple ingredients.
Chicken stock, the vital ingredient to good cooking. It transforms sauces. It's a fantastic base for soups. And more importantly, it's so easy to do. A little bit of love and care at the beginning and it cooks itself. Right, step one, chicken carcass into a high-sided pan. An onion, doesn't need to be finely chopped. The vegetables flavour the stock. Onion in. Then from there, cut your leek into nice big solid chunks. Roughly same size as the onion. So all the vegetables cook at the same time. And then a carrot. Celery in, garlic, and then a nice sprig of thyme. That helps to really give depth of flavour to the chicken stock. A couple of bay leaves and some fresh parsley. And then peppercorns. Pan and just lightly crush them. And a little pinch of salt. And now just cover the vegetables and the carcass with cold water. Just cover the chicken and the vegetables. Bring it up to the boil as quick as you can. Now, as it comes up to the boil, a really nice skim. Take the base of the ladle and swirl that around. That pushes all the grease and the impurities to the side of the pan. Then get your ladle and just tilt it. If you don't skim all that off, then the stock becomes very cloudy. People's impression of cooking stock that it needs to cook for 3-4 hours at a time. This is one chicken carcass. Let that boil away gently for 30 to 40 minutes maximum. Now, we're gonna pass it off. Take a sieve, place that over the pan, and then just pour that in. It smells amazing. It's aromatic. The colour is absolutely beautiful. And there you have the most amazing stock.
When you need to season meat in flour, a great tip is to place it in a plastic bag to dust it evenly. Using flour also helps the sauce to get nice and thick during cooking. When browning meat, fry it in small batches. Don't crowd the pan, otherwise it won't sear or colour properly. When slow roasting meat, line the bottom of the roasting tray with chunky vegetables like onions, fennel and carrots. They act as a trivet to keep the meat from boiling in its own juices. Plus, the veg can be the base for your gravy later on. After slow cooking, baked on residue can be tough to remove, but if you boil water in the pan, it will dissolve and break down. Then simply pour out and wash with soap and water. First up, red pepper. As you've seen, great for frittata and North African eggs, but you need to know how to cut them properly.
I absolutely love these peppers. Now, they have the most amazing, sweet, delicious flavour with a really nice, crunchy texture. And the most exciting thing about the peppers is that they're just as delicious raw or cooked. To identify the perfect pepper, it must be smooth and firm and not a wrinkle in sight. Now, how to cut the perfect pepper? Stalk off, pepper down, and get the knife, start from the top, and slice all the way around. Basically, we're going to be slicing around the seeds. Look, no faffing around, like this little perfect Christmas tree of seeds, and you haven't got the mess all over your board, and more importantly, it's twice as quick. Discard that. Now, we're going to cut it into a julienne. Flatten the pepper, skin side down onto the board, because it's a lot easier to slice through the pepper, and just lift the knife up and down. And basically, julienne is a chef's word for strips. These are absolutely perfect for a sauté. And that's what we're looking for there. Crunchy, delicious, and more importantly, no seeds. Beautiful.
Many great brunch recipes start with a delicious fresh egg. My tried and tested way to tell if your egg is fresh is to simply place it into a bowl of cold water. A fresh egg will sink and a stale one will float. If a small piece of shell goes into the bowl when you're cracking eggs, my tip for removing it is to simply use a larger piece to fish it out. It works like magic. For prize-winning fried eggs, fry them in oil, adding a tablespoon of water, then cover. The water steams the top of the egg to perfection. Toasted bagels are brilliant for brunch. My tip to make sure you always have them on hand is to stock up your freezer. But make sure you slice them first. That way, you can pop them straight into your toaster. Fruit can be a great healthy option for brunch, and knowing how to get the best out of it can make all the difference. First up, how to peel and cut a mango the easy way. Holding its stalk end up, cut either side of the stone, cut all the way into the flesh, making squares without cutting through the skin. Then turn it inside out and carefully cut your pieces off. A great tip to check if a pineapple is ripe is to pull a leaf out from the top. If it comes away easily, it's ripe and ready for slicing. My tip to get the flesh out of a kiwi is to simply cut the fruit in half and scoop it out with a teaspoon. Try it, it really works. If you have fruit that's not perfectly ripe, the tip is to put a banana in a paper bag, then add your unripe fruit. Put it in a dark place and the banana will speed up the ripening process of the other fruit. You can make a great fruit puree to accompany a brunch pancake or a crumpet in a blender. To clean it afterwards, add a cup of warm water and run the machine for a few seconds. Empty out, then simply repeat with a drop of washing up liquid, then rinse. Now, here are five more of my essential cooking tips, starting with how to cook an ingredient that's perfect for a quick and easy TV dinner, chicken breasts.
This has to be the most popular part of the chicken. Now, it's very versatile, incredibly tender, very lean, hardly any fat whatsoever. The secret is cooking it without it becoming dry. The first thing is to season it properly, both sides. 2 tablespoons of olive oil. Get the pan nice and hot. The secret now is to get a really nice colour on the skin. Really nice colour. No colour, no flavour. Skin side down. Tilt the pan so it cooks the back of the chicken breast where it's really nice and round and very fat. Let the pan do the work. Chicken breast normally takes between sort of 10 and 12 minutes to cook properly. Now we've got the colour on the skin. The skin's nice and crispy. We're going to deglaze the pan. Deglaze with masala. Now, masala is a sweet, fortified Italian wine. You can also use white wine. Masala in. Flambé. Burn off the alcohol, which gets rid of that really sort of harsh alcoholic flavour. Roll the chicken around the masala. Deglazing the pan basically means washing the pan and lifting off all that flavour stuck to the bottom of the frying pan and putting it into the sauce. Now, chicken stock. Bring that up to the boil and let it simmer for 3 to 4 minutes. really important to leave the chicken breast skin side up. The skin's nice and crispy, and it's important now the chicken cooks from underneath. As it starts cooking, it absorbs the stock. So in the centre of the chicken, it stays nice and moist. Now the stock of the masala is reduced down, you can have the confidence to allow it to almost disappear. And look, the combination between the masala and the chicken stock is quite sweet, so it finishes the chicken with this really nice, delicious glaze on top. And there you go, a delicious, succulent chicken breast with the most amazing, flavoursome skin. Phenomenal.
Soups make stunningly simple meals. My tip for adding incredible depth of flavour is to always keep your leftover Parmesan rinds. Store them in the freezer, then add to the pan as the soup cooks and leaves to infuse. Then remove before serving, it's less waste and more taste. Another tip to take homemade soup to the next level, whisk in cubes of cold butter just before serving to get a glossy, velvety texture and a beautifully rich taste. Another fantastic standard for a fuss-free weekend eat is the classic baked potato. My tip for a great crispy skin is to use salt to your advantage. Simply add it to the outside before cooking and the salt will draw out the moisture in the oven as it bakes. A touch of salt gives you an amazingly crisp skin on chicken and fish too, as well as highlighting the flavour. Home-roasted nuts make a delicious TV snack. My tip for peeling them with ease is to simply toast them in the oven for about 10 minutes, wrap in a tea towel and rub until the skins are removed. Perfect sprinkle with sea salt and serve with a glass of wine. First up, the proper way to chop fresh herbs to get maximum flavour.
Chopping herbs, the secret is to chop them, not bruise them. Now, basil. This is a soft herb, so treat it with some respect. When people go mad chopping herbs, all the goodness comes out on the board. I want the goodness left inside the basil. Place them all inside one another with the largest leaf at the bottom, and it's almost like rolling a cigar. Large one at the bottom, small ones in the centre, and then look, place them down together, and just roll them. Nice and gently, don't bruise them. Step one, rolled, ready to slice. Sharp knife, imperative. Fingers tucked in. The bottom part of your knuckle is the guide between you and the herbs. That there stops you from cutting your finger. Really important to get comfortable with a knife and just practice rolling the knife across the board and relaxing that wrist. It's all in the wrist action. So, herbs up, fingernails tucked underneath, and just up and down, up and down. And there you have a chopped basil that's not bruised and smelling very fragrant. Right, coriander. So you get the bunch of coriander, hold it down, and just lightly shave the leaves off the stalks. Bunch them up together, and then just, again, let the knife do the work. Tuck the fingernails in and just chop once, and once only. Don't hack it, just chop it. You can always identify when you've bruised the herb, when you've removed the herbs off the board, and there's a big green patch. Mmm, full of flavour, and none of the goodness is left on the chopping board.
A great tip for using leftover herbs, simply chop finely, mix into butter, roll up in cling film, and freeze. Then when you want a herby hit, cut into slices and melt over steaks, chicken, or veg. Asparagus is great for a simple supper. To prepare, always remove the lower woody stem by gently bending, and the asparagus will snap at the perfect point. Then boil or steam and serve with a little of my herb butter. For a cracking soft-boiled egg, simply place your egg in boiling water, add a splash of vinegar and cook for exactly 8 minutes. Then plunge into ice water. The vinegar helps the shell peel off easily, and the ice water stops the egg from cooking, giving you the perfect runny yolk. For fuss-free salad dressings, simply add the ingredients into a jam jar. Screw the lid on tightly and shake to combine in seconds. There's no need to wash up a whisk, and the jar's ready-made to store any leftovers. 100 tips to help your special occasion cooking better. Kicking off with how to prepare prawns.
To prep it, get the head and twist. Keep hold of those heads, the most amazing stock. And then with your thumb, get underneath the shell and just peel off that beautiful little layer. Now, with your thumb and your finger, push and shake, and look, the whole tail comes off. You don't have to peel the whole thing. From there, get your knife and just gently cut the surface of the prawn. And what we're looking for there is that little dirt sack. That's got to come out, otherwise, if you cook the prawn with that sack in there, it's crunchy, it's not very nice, and it ruins that sweet flavour. And there you go, the most amazing prawn ready for cooking.
Serving whole fish always makes an impact. Here's how to fillet it at the table. Run a knife along the backbone, remove the skin, and carefully lift off the portions of flesh using a fish slice. Then just lift off the backbone in one careful movement. Whole hams are always impressive. To carve one easily, hold the ham by the bone and cut down the meat as close to the bone as possible. You can then lay your cut ham flat on the board, making it nice and easy to slice thinly and evenly. For perfect pork crackling, pour over hot oil before roasting in the oven. It'll come out beautifully crisp and crunchy. And when you need to chill wine fast, simply add a large handful of salt to your ice bucket. The salt reduces the freezing point of the water, which will chill your wine in 6 minutes flat. Tomatoes are another salad staple. Here's how to skin them for extra refinement. Score each one with a cross at the bottom. Blanch in boiling water for a minute. Then shot them in cold water and the skins will easily peel away. Pomegranates are a fabulous fruit for adding glamour to salads or desserts. The trick to getting the seeds out, slice in half lengthways, make slits around the edge, turn upside down over a bowl, and using a large spoon, whack as hard as you can to release the seeds. To take fabulous fruit puts to the next level, my tip is to add sophisticated quenelles of ice cream or lemon mascarpone. Simply dip 2 metal spoons in hot water, scoop, shape, and add. And after baking, never throw out your leftover pastry. It's easy transformed into grapefruit or savory party nibbles. Roll out, grate parmesan or sprinkle over your favorite fruit, roll, and then just slice and bake.